A second credit rating downgrade for Barbados in less than a week. And in sport, England takes command of the third and final ODI at the Kensington Oval. I'm Ricardo Roberts, and this is Caribbean in 10 for Thursday, March 9. I'll be back with the details after the break.
Grow your business or promote your event through the services offered by the Caribbean Media Corporation and Carib Vision. Our distribution provides a platform on cable, terrestrial television, and websites. We cover carnivals and events from across the region. We can bring your event live and alive to the world. For music makers, program producers, businesses, we can expand your reach to in excess of 2 million households daily. Our other services include news updates to enhance your media products, studio space for program and development. We can facilitate the launch of new products and services and training. Contact us and we will help you unleash your creative ability, develop products and services, and provide the medium to watch them grow. Contact Loretta Skeet at cmccaribbean.com or call her 1-246-467-1044 or 1-246-253-3889. Call and book your carnival or event today.
Barbados has been downgraded for the second time in less than a week. This time, it's by international ratings agency Moody's, which downgraded the island's government bond and issuer rating to CAA3 and maintained a stable outlook. Moody's said Thursday that the reason for the downgrade was due to continued increase in government debt and limited prospects for fiscal reform. It also said that rising domestic and external financing pressures are likely to impair government's ability to service its debt. Last Friday, Standard & Poor's downgraded Barbados and issued a negative outlook for the island. It also warned that the sustainability of the dollar is under threat amid government's continued reliance on the central bank to finance its deficit. The legislation that Trinidad and Tobago needed to pass to comply with the U.S. Foreign Account Tax Compliance Act, FATCA, has now received the approval of both houses of parliament. After passing in the House of Representatives on February 23rd, it got the nod from the Senate on Tuesday night. It now has to go to President Anthony Comuna for his assent. Finance Minister Colm Imbert says the next step is to now ensure that all systems are in place for the legislation to go into operation. Kamal Georges of CNC3 News reports.
Both sides voted in favor of the Tax Information Exchange Bill, which required a three-fifths majority. 29 members in favor, none against.
Mr. Kreese?
Abstain.
But there was one abstention.
The motion for the third reading of the Tax Information Exchange Agreements, United States of America, Bill 2016, is approved.
With the bill resolved, Finance Minister Colm Imbert said the country can now breathe a little easier. In a statement today, Minister Imbert said this country has avoided the adverse consequences of loss of correspondent banking, imposition of withholding taxes, de-risking, and debanking.
We are complying with FATCA because it makes common sense to do so.
During his wrap-up on Tuesday night, Minister Imbert stressed that it made practical business sense to comply with the legislation. He says the risk of loss of correspondent banking would have made trade with the United States challenging for businesses.
When we say that if you don't pass this legislation, there will be adverse consequences, we're not making it up. These are facts. You can look around the world. You can look at all around the world at countries that have lost correspondent banking, that have been victims of de-risking.
Minister Imbert says focus is now on working with the Board of Inland Revenue and the Central Bank to implement the necessary systems to meet the reporting deadline of September.
With Jamaica's Finance Minister Audley Shaw expected to announce additional taxes when he opens the budget debate this afternoon, financial commentator David Wan says the government is likely to go to the route of indirect taxation to raise revenues for the 2017-2018 fiscal year. Indirect taxation is a tax levied on goods and services rather than on income or profits. Speaking to RJR News, Wan gave an insight into what he thinks could be announced by Minister Shaw.
I expect that there will be some increase in indirect taxation as opposed to income taxes anywhere to help fund the second phase of the 1.5 million tax threshold reduction, increasing of the tax threshold to 1.5. So I think it could possibly come from taxes such as petrol or bringing some items onto non-tax exempt into taxable as some examples of what indirect taxation could be.
Stay with us. Your Midday Sport is next.
Paycheck, there's a lot more stuff taken out than I had expected.
I work for the state, so there's a lot of deductions.
Social Security, L&I tax,
unemployment, income tax.
Then the number that you actually get is after they take all those three out.
Where exactly goes, I have no idea.
FICA, that's the federal insurance. Hold on.
FICA means...
It'd be an F, an I, C, and an A, okay?
West Indies have won the toss and sent England in to bat in the final one-day international of the three-match series at the Kensington Oval in Barbados today. They are currently facing a series whitewash, a fate they earnestly attempt to avoid. Today, England has taken a commanding lead after opening batsman Alex Haley smashed a century to put his side well past 200, losing only 2 wickets. He was dismissed on 110. West Indies have made one change, bringing in 20-year-old pacer Alizari Joseph for his first game in the series to replace the injured Shannon Gabriel. The visitors hold a winning 2-0 lead in the series following back-to-back victories at the Vivian Richards Cricket Stadium in Antigua last weekend. Now, at Stubbs, the West Indies are currently 263-5 with England, on 263-5 with still a lot of batting to go. Let's take a look at what's happening over at the Kensington Oval.
Bowled at a tough time here, Joseph, and he's picked up 3 wickets, 3 for 62. On goal. Make that 4 for. Good spell this for the West Indies. Young Joseph, 20 years of age, he's got 4 for. He's got great heart. Talked about it being a learning curve for him. He can smile now. Another cutter, I think, and is held up in the surface again. It keeps doing that on this pitch, into the grassy areas. It's holding in the surface. Another little bonus moment for the West Indies in the last 7 overs. Nought to Ali, 264 for 6.
And there you have it, youngster Alizari Joseph taking his 3rd wicket in the match. We see Ian Morgan going back to the stands. That's Caribbean in 10. Join us again at 6:30 for Caribbean Newsline. Good afternoon.